The answer is to not ask the question. The answer is to not ask the question. The answer is to not ask the question. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Here we are again, which is a great thing. So we're not in a rush. We're quietly wandering about, just noticing this and this and that. Okay. We're not trying to reach a goal or a destination. It's a linear fashion. Adjust this a little bit. Oh, well, that went differently than I thought. How is that possible? Okay. That's fine. Welcome again. Just settle in, settle in, settle in. May 5th, 2016. I was listening to a song today. From I think this the early 70s, old-fashioned singing by George Jones, Tammy Wynette, and the song sounds so good it sounds subversive right now. It sounds subversive, and I said, "Wait a minute, or is it 216 that's subversive?" Oftentimes, when you start out, you have to gather yourself, gather your focus, gather your attention, your intention, and start to get centered in. Okay? This is a good thing. So I'll just kind of walk, start ambling along here. We kind of amble along. Okay. Today, last night, I stayed up till 2:30 in the morning. I was doing all these holy cards. Here's an example of a holy card that I was doing. And here's another one. So I was doing all these holy cards and really enjoying it, and it was really fabulous. And it got so beautiful that it was just knocking me out, absolutely knocking me out. And so finally I stopped, and then I don't know what I did. I searched for Creative Commons. It's a Beautiful Morning. That's what the Young Rascals. I just felt like the song sort of encapsulates how I was feeling. It's a beautiful, morning, da da da. And I wanted Creative Commons. Well, there wasn't any, but there was a song called "Oh, What a Beautiful Morning," Creative Commons. I said, "Ah, that's not the Rascals." Finally, I said, "Well." I was kind of hoping, like, maybe it is. I knew it wasn't, but I said, maybe it is. So I clicked on it. And I listened to it. I said, that's not bad. It was some man with acoustic guitar singing. I said, actually, that's kind of nice. And so I checked on his channel, and I came across this other song. His, what's his name? Bradford Soldano or Soldan? And this other song that he did, it just knocked me out. And the video that went with it, I was just knocked out by it. It was so unexpected. His style is so different. And the video, the tastefulness of everything, it was just so amazing. I just was knocked out by it. And I just, I won't forget that. That just knocked me out. He's so different and good. So I woke up in the morning and I was thinking about that after not so much any hours of sleep. I was driving along And I was thinking, maybe, you know, someday maybe I'd like to sing with him. You know, maybe I can, someday we can sing a duet or something. I just felt so inspired. I just felt so inspired by it. It was amazing. Now, I haven't sung in a long time. I quit it. I'm not thinking about it. I used to practice all the time, really try, but gave it up. Finished. But I was so inspired. That's how inspiring this song was. It just absolutely threw me for a loop. It's redefining song. The way he does it is really beautiful. And so I said, well, oh, I have a CD. I haven't used it for 4 or 5 years. I haven't even turned the CD player on in maybe 5 years. 5 years, really. In the vehicle. So I you know, hit play, and here's this song. Imagine, yeah, a world with nobody. George Jones, Picture of Me Without You. I said, oh, wow. I like that song. Maybe I'll sing along. So, started singing along. Yeah, I said, like, whoa, I'm a doesn't sound so good. And so I tried to sing a little better and a little better. And said, oh, I got to get. I don't want to sound terrible. Come on, this little pride gets in there. And says, come on, you can do better than that. So I started singing, warming up the voice, and before too long, I was really belting it out and singing. I was like, wow, I could still sing. Holy cow. I quit singing like over a year ago, last time I sang, when I sang the best I've ever sung before in my life. I woke George Jones up from the dead. And I said, okay, you know, whatever. I'm still deluded. So what good does that do? And that's the last time I sang. And so it's kind of like riding a bicycle for me. I just like, got on the bike, started riding. I said, hey, I could do this. And in church, I just joined voices with others. You know, we're just joining voices in church. But singing solo is like you have to, you know, carry the song and belt it out with intensity and sustain the voice and project it and you know, really sing it out. So I was singing it out. And put my ear, you know, hand here with my here to hear it, you know, and then the voice like this, and you can really hear how you sound when you go like this, actually. And it was really good. I said, wow, I can still sing. Quite shocking. Quite shocking. Yeah, I can sing, you know, I'll always be able to sing now. I've practiced so much this lifetime, sang so much that it's just, you know, I can do it now. And what I found was that all this exercise I've been doing, hopefully one day, you know, play golf to just be in good shape so that yoga girls can't shame me too much and, you know, all this other stuff, the ab work and everything I've done has created like a lot more, you know, strength, physicality in terms of strength of singing. So, but what I didn't have was stamina. I had no stamina. After about a half an hour, I couldn't really sing loud anymore. It's gone. I could sing, but it was softer singing, and couldn't belt it out, not so much. So this is like really amazing. I'm quite shocked by it. The Holy Spirit tricked me into singing again. So I might start practicing again, actually, when I'm driving. I may start practicing again. I went out and bought a Hubert's lemonade. This is the key. If you really want to sound good, drink Hubert's lemonade. It's astringent. It tightens the vocal cords and it protects them, the sweetness in it also. And you'll find you can sing a lot better if you're singing loud. I mean, full volume. And of course, when you're like in rush hour traffic, what else is there to do? Not gonna listen to the radio, and I can tape. You know, I do that, or I said, well, let me try singing. Nobody can hear you sing in the vehicle is in rush hour traffic. So Now, I don't have a particularly good voice, is the only issue. I sound better when I'm singing with other someone else, kind of. I'm not really like a lead singer in terms of, having that distinctive quality of voice that's just, sounds good. The voice itself just sounds good. But technically, I mean, I can sing just fine. Very creative, and I feel very confident, in singing. I can do anything I want to do. I've been singing my whole life, actually. Never used it for anything, though. I tried to find a way to use it. This Bradford goes into hospice, assisted living care homes, and sings for people as a therapeutic practice. And the funny thing is, that's what I was practicing for a long time. The Holy Spirit somehow led me to, I was starting to go into these assisted living homes and singing. And I got a one time I went in, and this lady was crippled and been in a wheelchair. She got out of her wheelchair and started dancing. It's like amazing. Everybody's like astonished. But I said, well, but that's not enlightenment. It's not, sure, it makes them feel better. Maybe it can heal some affliction. But I'm aiming higher than that. Aiming higher than that. That's not means there's anything wrong with it. Now, got home today, and I waded into Buddhist history and all that stuff. Just somehow, I was just waiting in here, waiting there, and waiting into it. I said, "Oh man, if you want to wade into something, how about wading into Tibetan lineages of Tibetan Buddhism? If you want to be discouraged about spiritual truths, just do that. I mean, it's like it's all lineages. I mean, everybody that's ever practiced is in some lineage in Tibet, and it's just like." Never ending, and all these names, compounded names, so many different names. I can't remember any of them. I mean, it's ridiculous. Wow. And then you get into the history of the Yogacara and Madhyamaka and the various schools and their arguments about the self, whether you should, how to, and then the disputes they still have, and it's not been solved. And realize all this stuff is still, all of these questions are still with us. And weighing us down, it's like, because they'll ask you the questions. Like, if you're enlightened, they'll say, okay, well, is the self like, without empty, or is it, they ask you these questions and stuff. And Buddhism loves, they love to ask questions. Nobody asks more questions than Buddhist. And my answer would be, look, the answer is don't ask the question. Okay, and this is the fifth turning of the wheel. In Buddhism, there's like been three turnings of the wheel at Deer Park and Vulture Peak, and then one more in Basali or something like that. Well, I think before he passed away. And some say, that they're definitive, or they require some more explanation. Some say the second turning was definitive. Kalugpa, I think, says that. And some say the third, and then some say the fourth turning was Vajrayana, Tibetan Buddhism, Vajrayana Buddhism in Tibet, the Tantra given out by practice given out by Padmasambhava. That's the fourth turning. Well, I say there's a fifth turning right now. And this is what Longchenpa is helping out with in Jesus. They're helping out this fifth turning. Okay, the fifth turning of the wheel of Buddhism. And it's different. It's that everything is eternal. But actually, if you read carefully, that's what they say too, actually. We haven't really gotten Buddhism accurately explained. And Jesus says, everything, all in all, all in all. Everything is what it appears to be, as well as pure potential to be everything and anything else. So everything is just the fullness of God. Everything is. There's only the fullness of God. There's nothing else other than that. So this is the fifth turning of the wheel. Longchenpa is turning the wheel for the fifth turning of the wheel. And the fifth turning of the wheel, the best is simply silence. The teacher is just silent, like Ram Maharshi. That's like a fifth turning of the wheel. And I'm ready for that. Oh, wow. You know, the answer to the questions is don't ask the question. The answer to your question is don't ask the question. What need does the self need to have some question answered or some philosophical point pointed out? The self doesn't need that. And, you know, they say that what the self is empty, meaning as soon as you have a concept of a self, that's not it. So they say, no, it's just voidness or emptiness. They don't mean literally. They mean don't try to conceptualize it. And I understand that that is very true. And the others say, well, it's you need to explain it, you know, give explanation. And then one of the Rimei people, Tulkus or Rinpoches, whatever, says, you know, well, one is good for dissolving concepts, and the other is good for explaining. So he's trying to end this dispute that's been going on for thousands of years. But the fifth turning of the wheel, we just say, you know, not asking the question is the answer. Not asking the question is the answer. Now, Sri Sri Anandamayi. I had an epiphany today. I've been so mad at her. Really so angry because she promised to come and she didn't come. She didn't return. And I just, you know, I just went through so much and just so disappointed. I'm just so disappointed. It's more just a severe disappointment. But today I saw it in a different light. I saw, the thing about her is she had no spiritual ego at all. It was devoid. And it's like impossible for us to understand that, really. And what I found out was, I believe, is that she didn't abandon me. She just put herself last and put everybody else first. And she says, I want you to study Jesus more closely. Come on, you're doing great with the Course in Miracles. I want you to really, really, really get that. And I want you to really, really discover Ram Maharshi and really become, you know, really get that. I want you to meet Longchenpa and really get what he has to say. Because I was so wrapped up in her, I didn't pay attention to anything else. And she said, no, I want you to pay attention to these other teachers. It's not about me. She said, it's not about me. I want you to be ecumenical. I want you to be, have this. She was totally ecumenical. And so she says, I want you to be at ease in all these traditions and feel comfortable. So she put herself out of the limelight and just said, it's not about me. Go pay attention to these other teachers, not me. Don't pay attention to me anymore. And of course, I didn't like this. It's been grievous. You know, there's nobody, there's no greater guru than Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. There's no greater guru. Never has been. Never will be. You know, top shelf. Perfectly versed in every approach, not versed, but in her Lila of Sadhana and Bhajapur, she took every approach, she actually lived through every approach, just, I don't know, hundreds of thousands, it's just so many, it's just, you can't even count. And she did it super rapidly. I mean, this is just, you know, you cannot even understand what a great guru this was. Cannot, it's impossible, you cannot understand it. But no spiritual ego, none. So she, it's not about her. It's never about her. It's about you. You know, she looks at you, it's about you. And what's going to help you? So she'll send you to some other teacher and say, you know, no, listen to this one. It's not about me. It's about them. Go listen to them. And puts herself last, she's making sure that I put all these other teachers first, ahead of her. That's what a great teacher she is. That's all heart, isn't it? I mean, it's just pure, clear heart. And really, that really brought tears to my eyes and streaming down my cheeks. It's just like, wow. You know, maybe I see what you've been doing. if you hadn't have done that, I would not have gotten this true broad ecumenical outlook, which is so important. The fifth turning of the wheel is pure ecumenicalism, actually. And so I'm versed in so much right now, really. I feel home everywhere. And I feel at home not asking any questions. So just sitting silently, like with Ram Maharshi, this is the best. This is the strongest wow. You're not asking any questions anymore. What kind of questions does the self need to ask? Now, one thing that Jesus has done is he explains better than most, and maybe better than anyone, the causal situation that we're in terms of why are we trying to get enlightened in the first place? What's the trouble? And it's arrogance, plain and simple. So in Christianity we say, original sin, meaning we're here because of arrogance. And it's not that there's people sunken in ignorance and they're lower down and all stuff. They are simply in a state of arrogance. They're trying to be greater than reality. So it's not that Buddha is some great being, enlightened being. It's that we're trying to be greater than Buddha. So we're all freaked out. This freaks us out. Now if we just stop trying to do that, then we're Buddha mind, natural mind, sky-like mind. It's not that we're lower than sky-like mind. It's that we're trying to get higher than it. And this is Jesus' very great clarification, which really helps do the turning of the fifth wheel here. This puts a lot of questions to rest, actually. The problem with Buddhism, it generates too many questions. It's inherently that way. Christianity may generate too few questions. You get too lackadaisical. Not asking questions is an intense state. You get a little sluggish. Christianity tends to get a little sluggish, stall out, whereas Buddhism asks way too many questions. And when Jesus came back, it's been a little over a year, and we're just past the anniversary, or this may even be the anniversary. It was late April, early May. I can't quite remember, but so it's been a year. All he said was, "I've just come back to relate with you as friends." That's it. Relate with you as friends. That's all he said. He didn't say, "I came back to answer all your questions" or anything like that. And I find this is produces an instant wow. If you want an instant wow, just take this perspective. Or let's throw this one here in the mix. Okay. Yeah, I had a lot of fun with this artwork, believe me. Are you kidding me? I mean, just to be able to put this together and come up with this, it's just like, wow. You see, what we are doesn't have any questions. It's unquestionably what it is. So when we keep asking questions, we're kind of saying that we're not what we really are. But when we stop asking questions and just abide, I'm not asking any questions. It's like we're aligning. We feel aligning with what we are. And the ego's like scared. Say, whoa, I got a lot of questions. No, just the answer to the question is don't ask the question. That's the answer. All right, so we're wandering around here. You see, we quickly notice all sorts of stuff. We've already gotten into very great intensity, haven't we? What? A fifth wheel? Everything's eternal. There's no impermanence. Don't ask the question. Why? This is all like a turning of the wheel, isn't it? Absolutely, it's a turning of the wheel. Fifth turning of the wheel. So Longchenpa and Jesus are helping out with this fifth turning of the wheel, and so is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, as is Ram Maharshi. Okay, they're helping with this fifth turning of the wheel of Dharma, spiritual protection, protecting pure perception through abidance. Abidance. Now, here's a little trick that was suggested to me. When we are abiding and people want to try to pull us out of that, so they feel lower the bar, so they feel, well, I don't have so high to go. You're down here with me. I don't need to do anything. I could just stitch up over that bar easy. This is just standard laziness, is they try to just lower the bar and think that then they don't need to do anything. If you have a bar like you try to jump over, it's 4 feet high or something, you say, well, I really got to get in shape to jump over that bar. But if you lower the bar down to 1 foot, you could just kind of hop over and say, oh, yeah, see, I can do it, no problem. I don't need to get in shape. I'm already in shape. This is just a classic maneuver, right? Lower the bar, which takes you out of abidance. So what we want to say is, of course, they're going to say, well, how'd you do it? And that takes you out of it right away. He's trying to explain to them. Before you know it, you're all frustrated and confused. So what you can say is, I don't know, but I do what I know I did do intentionally was I sort of placed the how I did it awareness in some place in the future, and I'm going to access it in the future. I'm not going to access it right now because now is a time of action, because we're reaching this event horizon, this extreme weirdness, extreme strangeness, however you want to say it, extreme weirdness. We're coming upon it now. And it's a time of action in some regard. So I said, well, I don't. If I had the explanation, then I spent all the time explaining it to you, and you'd be caught up in this battle of trying to lower the bar. But if I don't remember how I did it at this point, then we can kind of avoid that, can't we? So I don't know how I did it right now, but I know how I did it. But I placed it in the future so it wouldn't interfere with my action right now. So how about that for a great response? Try that out. Give that consideration, because you know when you're in abidance, you know that there's this pressure to lower the bar. So others feel like, oh, more relieved because they start feeling nervous. Like, hey, I mean, someone just set the bar so high, I can't seem to jump over that bar. I can't seem to get in. And they kind of feel like, maybe, I might have to change my life and do all that. Oh no, maybe it's easier just to lower the bar. So they'd say, well, let me give it a try. And it's just like automatic, automatic, automatic. I mean, how many people just see the bar high and just go, ah, oh, and just sit there and just say, yeah, wow. That's the right response. Because when you see someone who's in abidance, you just, wow. Just be quiet, don't ask any questions. Well, what questions they're asked? The whole thing's obvious. You need to get with it. That's all. If you take laziness out of the equation, then what questions are there really? It's just obvious. You need to get down to business. But if you refuse to get down to business, then you start asking all these questions, which are really saying, I don't really need to get down to business, and here's why. Because you really haven't answered my questions about why should I really get down to business. That's all really all it is, right? So we just say, I don't remember that. The guru knows, but I don't remember how. What did I do? I don't know, but I know that I know. But I know that I sort of placed it like a term of treasure. I placed it in the future. At some point, when it's time to give explanations, I'll remember exactly, how I reached enlightenment. But right now, it's just, I intentionally kind of block on that, so I really can't answer, even discuss any of that stuff. It's just sort of a blank for me. But see, this really then, flips the script on all this lowering the barness. At least it can help. So we're practical here. We're pragmatic and we're practical. Sure, abidance is possible. Just drop your arrogance in your natural mind right away. It's right there. It's just we just relax into it. If we let go of our arrogance, we just relax right into it, and that's it. Our arrogance is that we think we can change what we are. When we stop trying to change what we are, we are what we are, just like that. There's nothing we need to do. Just stop trying to change what we are. It's very simple. So Jesus is the master of simplicity, which is great. At least that's how I experience, what he has to say. Now, not everybody may experience it that way, but I do. Just there's nothing you need to do at all, except just relax. Stop trying to do something to yourself. Stop trying to change what you are, and you're it. You realize you are it. I'm it. Everything is it. Everything is it. As Ananda Maimon said, everything is God. Everything is it. So I was such a devotee of Sri Sri Ananda Maimon that, she thought it was best for me to shift out of that. I was getting too wrapped up into it. And I tried to popularize it here in the West and it got nowhere. And it was just devastating for me. You find that when you get stuff that's the most precious and valuable here, nobody pays, almost no one pays attention. It's really extraordinary. It's so frustrating. But don't let that frustration get to you. Keep clarifying. I have all these beautiful holy cards. Can I share them with people? Are you gonna? Well, not a few people. I mean, I have all this stuff up on Flickr and so much stuff. But nobody looks at it. It's like, wow. There you go. There's another one, huh? I mean, how cool is that? Longchenpa is helping us. Longchenpa is helping us. I'm telling you about the heavyweights. The heavyweights are turning, doing the fifth turning of the wheel now. Okay? This is what's happening here. And when you talk about heavyweights, you're talking about Longchenpa. Okay? This is a Buddhist heavyweight. Heavyweight of heavyweights. Really. When you're talking about Ram Maharshi, that we're talking about a heavyweight. You're talking about Sri Sri Anandamayi. You're talking about an extreme heavyweight, okay? Just and then you're talking about Jesus. You're talking about an extreme heavyweight, okay? Yes, sir. You certainly are. So these four, and maybe others, but they're certainly working to make this fifth turning of the wheel, because we're stuck. We're in trouble. We're going into this tremendous weirdness. And the truth of the matter is that the remedy. There has to be a remedy for this weirdness. So the remedy itself also may seem weird. It's extreme positivity, which is, most people will find that very weird. But it's better than the extreme weirdness of dualism that's coming. So pretty much just pick your weirdness right now. As you look at this picture here, you say, well, that's really weird. But you have to use your will to say, okay, well, but this is my path. I have to get used to this. And when I get used to it, it won't seem weird to me. Whereas the weirdness that takes weirdness as an end in itself, it just keeps getting weirder. Whereas this, it actually, it ends up in abidance in natural being, which isn't weird at all. It's natural to us. Whereas trying to be greater than what we are is not natural to us. It will always feel weird. Will always feel weird. Yeah. This one's kind of cool, huh? So these I've always wanted to make holy cards. It's one of my ambitions in life. I love holy cards. I feel it's important that art uses the saints as its theme. I feel this is very important. So this is what I try to do. When I do art, I try to use the saints as the theme. See this? So it's beautiful, huh? Yeah. And it helps us remain focused, doesn't it? So, for the grace of Longchenpa and the Holy Spirit, he's lent himself to this, and I've been able to do these holy cards now. And, it just knocks me out because a lifelong ambition, and I never could do it. I did a lot with Sri Sri Anandamayi, a lot of artwork, a lot. Unfortunately, I don't have any of it anymore because I got so upset with her, I threw it all away. I regret that, I did so much beautiful, just really sublime, but it was getting too intense. And people, I think, were looking at me like I was kind of too weird. It was too weird for them, okay? So it was spiritual, but it was so strong. It was too weird. People couldn't handle it. So now I kind of have things more balanced out, more smoothed out, and I can shift, much more flexible. So I mean, I did do some work, but this is, way, way better. This is just really, really beautiful, really sublime. Yeah, so it just knocks me out because it's a great ambition of mine to do this, and now I've done it, and it's better than I ever expected. Holy cow! I mean, to be graced by Longchenpa is just—it's just like a supreme grace. It's just—we we don't even understand hardly what a grace it is. He's not, less than the Buddha, really. It's a different transmission. It's a fifth turning of the wheel, as it were. But this isn't any less Buddha mind than Shakyamuni Buddha, and this is a great accomplishment. I mean, very accomplished, supremely accomplished. So this is a huge, huge blessing. If we knew how big it was, we would be in tears, and we wouldn't, it would just overwhelm us, I think. Part of the blessing of Longchenpa is nobody knows who he is hardly in the West, and he's just, he's just kind of the insiders know of Tibetan Buddhism. The Tibetan Buddhists, in the insiders, they know, but other than that, no. So people say, "Who's this?" I don't know. So it's like we don't realize what a blessing it is. We don't realize it. But I can tell you that his response, the responsiveness, is just amazing. And maybe, like I said, it's best that maybe we don't really know so much, or we'd freeze up. It would just be, we'd be overwhelmed with gratitude. It'd be just too much. So he's let himself, to making these holy cards I've been able to make, and it's just, it's been a process of doing it, and I've got, a lot more that I've done. I'm just showing a few here, and just think, here's someone doing the fifth turning of the wheel here. He said, "This is for us." Okay, he's doing it for us. He's not here for Buddhists. He's here for everyone. Okay, he's here for everyone. I gave an open ecumenical call for help. He didn't show up as a Buddhist. He showed up as a lifeguard with a red cross on his chest, guarding lives, guarding the Dharma, guarding our life, the truth of our life. He didn't show up as a Buddhist or anything in particular, and And nor is he not a Buddhist. You know, he represents, these teachers represent every tradition, really, at the top. They represent the top. The fifth turning is a different sort of thing. It's supremely ecumenical. So he's deserving of these beautiful frames. These frames are very beautiful. It's super tough to put someone in these frames, isn't it? But if you look at this, he can handle it, can't he? Doesn't matter how many flowers you put, surround him with. He has the presence. He absolutely has the presence to handle this. Just take a look at this. Yeah, just imagine me making this artwork last night and making like many, many, many of these, each one unique and different. And it's like, you know, I mean, maybe someone might make one of these and just say, you know, like, wow, I did some great. I made like 100 of them or something. It just kept knocking me out. I said, good, I live to be knocked out by beauty. That's what I live for, spiritual beauty. I live to be knocked out by it. I said, knock me out. I love it. It's like if you love music, you want to be knocked out by music, right? Absolutely you do. You want to hear something that just knocks you out, and you have that feeling, right? I'm just knocked out. So I'm that way. I love to be knocked out by just sublime, the sublime. I love to be knocked out by the sublime. So what I do with the artwork here is I try to, you know, knock myself out. Yeah, I try to knock myself out, and hopefully, you know, this knocks you out as well. It's knocking me out right now. This is very, very profound. Don't ask any questions. Try that. Don't ask any questions at all. And so, folks, these great teachers belong to everyone. They belong to everyone. And none of my Sri Sri Nanamaya Ma would say, I'm nobody's guru. Meaning I'm everybody's guru. So all these lineages and traditions and stuff like that, the fifth turning of the wheel lifts us up above that. Okay, all of that. Thank God. Sectarianism, a precursor to all this was Judah Krishnamurti, of course. And he talked about how the modern plague and just how we need to get beyond it. And so he was, you know, he rejected theosophy and his role there. And he said, we need to get to this fifth, there's a new turning of the wheel coming. And, you know, it's here now. When Longchenpa shows up, this is more than auspicious. This is someone who wrote the book. You know, he really wrote the book. And so, both literally and figuratively, he knows. The nature of mind, sky-like nature of mind. There is no two ways about it. And he understands our struggling in our arrogance to drop our arrogance and stop trying to be more than we are. So presenting these great Dharma kings and queens, it's a part of the fifth, this fifth turning of the wheel. So get with it. It's not that you have to get with Buddhism. Get with the fifth turning of the wheel. Now we're using a phrase out of Buddhism, which is fine. I use Christian phrases. I use various phrases. It's a good phrase to use. It is there's sort of these teachings. The first turning might be the Four Noble Truths and the this and that of how to, break your bad habits and how to get good habits and how to focus. And, then it gets more sophisticated. Then the next is on emptiness. Next teaching might be on emptiness and compassion. And the third turning, it might be on Buddha nature, Buddha mind, and fourth turning is on abidance, rapid getting one lifetime, getting to abidance in the clear light. And now we're here in the fifth turning, which I would say, the way to answer all these questions of Buddhism is to say that reality has no script. So all these philosophical questions, assuming that there's a script, there's no script. It's unscripted. It's never there's never a script in place. Okay, there's never a script in place. And this just knocks out so many questions. Just it's a knockout blow. To allow yourself to be knocked out. It's like Vajrayana, it's like a thunderbolt path. This is very much a thunderbolt path here. It's like our lightning bolt, lightning or thunderbolt. It's like lightning strikes near you, or thunder suddenly, boom, a vast clap of thunder right near you. And instead of getting freaked out, just say, "Oh, that's great! I love this! I love it! More thunder, please! More thunder! More lightning!" So this is easy to tell. Easy to tell if this is your path, if you're ready for the fifth turning of the wheel. If you say, "Ah, more lightning, please! I love that! I love to just be knocked out by spiritual aesthetics and spiritual truths, just knocking me out. I love it. More. I want more. I want more." Then that's it. You're part of the fifth turning of the fifth wheel. Yeah. Absolutely. Turning of the wheel for the fifth time. And the thing about singing is, let me see. Can we get another one here? It's similar. The thing about singing is, you have to be singing to people who want to be knocked out. Okay? They want to be knocked out by the singing. This is very important. Jesus is saying, "Do you want to be knocked out?" That's what he's really doing, knocking on your door. He says, "Hey, truth's gonna knock you out. Knock out the arrogance. You're gonna love it. Who loves to be knocked out by truth? The lightning bolts of truth. Who loves being knocked out by it?" Well, I do. I said, "Jesus, I do. Knock me out. Absolutely, knock me out. Are you kidding me? Knock me out right now. Knock me out right now." Love to be there. So, yeah. If you love that and say, "Yeah, I do love it." That's your part of this turning of the fifth wheel. Because it knocks you out. The simplicity, the truth, the realization, I am not trapped at all in philosophical discourses and troubles and arguments. I'm not trapped at all. I have the easy resolution. All that stuff is now resolved, it's resolvable. We have a better explanation. We have a better way. We really do. Just don't ask the questions. That's the answer. And let yourself be knocked out by it. This is the wow, full stop in the wow, right? Just, that just knocks me out hearing that. If you really like that, enjoy it. This then reveals to you where you're at. And this fifth turning of the wheel is necessary because the retrograde movement is so strong. There's nothing more foolish than being smart, okay? And so all this smartphone thing, you have a bunch of fools now. This is a planet of fools, a ship of fools here. I'm not smart. I don't want to be smart. The last thing I want to be is smart. I want to be wise. I want to be wise, not smart. Smartness is foolishness, because it's lowering the bar of wisdom into smartness. So everybody with these smartphones, the purpose is lower the bar. So you don't have wisdom anymore. You have just smart. You have the bar of smartness to jump over, not the bar of wisdom anymore. And then we think, we got it. We don't need to make any more effort. You know, don't need to focus our attention anymore on that. So, wisdom is the answer. And wisdom says there is ultimate wisdom. Where smartness disavows that there's any ultimate smartness. You can always get smarter. There's no ultimate. But wisdom says there is an ultimate. That our true nature is the ultimate, actually. Trouble is singing in churches. You gotta sing down. You don't want to sing to sound too good, because people like start looking at you like, wow, you know, you should be in the choir. I mean, yeah. So you have to sing, but sing down. It's pretty weird. It's kind of like modern day Christianity. You kind of gotta tone down your understanding of it, because you don't want people to say, wow, who do you think you are? I mean, are you one of the apostles or something? So you kind of got to play dumb a little bit. It's like the singing. You kind of got to not sing so well. And so then going back to singing well, it's kind of like, wow. You know, I wasn't sure if I could do it or not. And one of the great techniques is just have absolute confidence in yourself, that you are the self. This is very important. Not for a minute, just practice that. I'm already enlightened. We could say that. Is that not so? We're just trying to be more enlightened than enlightened. But that doesn't mean that enlightenment's any less, right? Just because we fail to be more than we are doesn't make what we are any less than what it is, right? So we're all enlightened. Everything is enlightened, actually. There's only enlightenment. That's all there is. I'm tired. I stayed up till 2:30. Probably didn't get to sleep till almost 3 as far as falling asleep, and got up at like got a call at 6:30, or woke up at 4:30 or something, and got up at 6:30. So not much sleep, but I said, got through the day okay, because I'm on a high. I'm on a spiritual high, which is a good thing to be on, right? And everybody knows that something's coming. There's no question that the talk, the way people are relating right now, is different. People are more open. They're talking about more in-depth stuff. There's sort of a desire to start opening up. Yeah, there really is. It really has shifted. And we're realizing, uh-oh, I got to get with some kind of weirdness here. Get with the positive non-dual weirdness, everyone. Get with that. It's beautiful. It's you know, it really has. Part of the importance is the holy cards. Is I want everybody to realize that there's great aesthetic beauty in this weirdness of non-dual weirdness, and the mind is intrinsically all beautiful. We're looking at the mind. When we look at this world, we're looking at the mind, and this world is just the tiniest drop in this endless ocean, actually, of beauty. The mind is all beautiful. So the ones who are really in trouble is the ones who try to not have any weirdness at all. Then they're going to have a meltdown. The ones who try to play it too cool, those are the ones in trouble. Because the weirdness of the world is of dualism is coming. And it's being engineered, and it's going to hit like a tidal wave, tsunami. And so to counteract that, we have to counteract that. To not counteract that, you know, that means we're going to, you know, be pulled down by that weirdness. So, of course, we have to counteract it. And counteracting, it has to be very strong medicine. So that very strong medicine may seem kind of weirdish also, right? Like this graphic right here. You look at it, you just say, wow, it's kind of weird. But it's also quite beautiful, isn't it? And quite evocative. You let your imagination be spiritual, taken the right way. It's like, wow. Very lovely. So there's music, there's art, and there's contemplation. There's a lot to the spiritual path, which is very beautiful. So we can turn to this, and that's why I'm making all this available. I don't know how to reach people. It's just the resources are being made available, but people are not picking up on it yet. So if anyone has any ideas about that, nothing seems to work so well. But just access to you know, really beautiful holy cards is very helpful. It's been used throughout history. It really has. It was a, you know, what are we too good for it now or something? I don't know. What are people using right now? I can't find anything they're using, actually. They're playing it too cool. Like, well, you know, I'm not going to have any weirdness. Well, avoiding weirdness seems weird. Just the very act of, but we came up with a term today. I was speaking with some friends, and I use the term positive weirdness. So that came up. Someone said he just is a grandfather for the first time. And I said, well, that's positive weirdness. He says, yeah. So what we're looking for is positive weirdness. He's because he's saying that's really weird for me. Another friend just had a first child, and he said it's really weird. I said, well, that's good. You know, positive weirdness is what we need. Positive weirdness is what we need. Counteract the negative weirdness. So we don't really, you know, pay attention to the negative weirdness. We have positive weirdness to pay attention to. Yeah, we can say, well, we're not rejecting weirdness. I mean, we still have it, you know. So we're not, you know, we just prefer positive weirdness. That's all. And you look at this, you say, well, that's kind of weird, positively weird, but Dharma King is just reciting, and you know, what cannot be defined, the unscriptedness of reality. Freedom, abiding in freedom. So if you want to, you this positive weirdness, you know, it's being made available. That's part of my job. That's what I've done. I have these, you know, four great turners of the wheel. And I'm putting out all this positive weirdness associated with them. And just, you know, let that be your entertainment. You don't need the weirdness on television. That's negative weirdness. That's still all this news. Good Lord. You know, it's just, that's super weird, isn't it? So come on over to the other side, to positive weirdness. Just come on over. I can, you know, I'm good at it. I'm very talented at it. That's why I'm doing this. I've spent a lifetime, really. Boy, you should have seen this, you know, some of this. Well, this is better. So Forget about the old stuff. I mean, whatever I did, this is better. I mean, this is really very, very nicely, nice and sublime. I did a lot of really great efforts and stuff, but you know, this really hits a strong chord. It's got some polish to it. Just say, hey, yeah, I enjoy positive weirdness. Like, in other words, really spiritual stuff. Most people say it's really weird. Just don't disagree. Say, yeah, it is. I mean, it feels weird, but it's got this positive weirdness to it, which is, I really love it. It just knocks me out in a positive way, whereas the negative stuff knocks us out in a negative way, doesn't it? Yeah, it certainly does. It's extremely negative, isn't it? Really terrible stuff, knocking us out, and it knocks us out in a downward negative depression spiral, doesn't it? Which is really weird. I mean, getting sick is really weird, isn't it? Getting depressed is really weird. And it's a very negative weirdness, though, but getting well is a positive weirdness. And I said to my friend today, I said, you know, getting old is really weird, isn't it? I'm just noticing, I was talking with this lady. She had like a Brooklyn accent, a New York Brooklyn accent, and she was kind of stylish and looking very sharp. She's a wealthy lady. I think she lives in a retirement community or something. She's got money. She's intelligent, real sharp. You're one of these, and you know, that kind of lady has always intimidated me. But we were talking about smartphones in the store. This lady said she bought a smartphone. We were talking about it, and she said no. I refuse to be a slave to fashion. And I said, me too. And so we're like agreeing on everything. We're having this wonderful conversation. It's like I've never had a conversation like that with a person like that. And she's like my generation, kind of, maybe a little older. And I realized, you know, where have we been our whole lives? It's very sad, isn't it? I've been in a cave. But where's she been? We're really good people, you know. We're smart. are wise, let's say, we're wise. And she said, look, she agreed with me, I agree with her. She says, these people, you know, it's just, they think they're sophisticated. They can't think. They don't know how to reason. They don't know how to think. They think everything's just on the smartphone, just touch, 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 and there's the answer. And they don't know how to write or think or do any of this. Communicate. I mean, in terms of, you know, it's just, and she kept saying, don't be a slave to fashion, in her nice New York accent. Very, New Yorkers tend to be, sound very adamant. It might have been a Brooklyn accent. It's beautiful. I mean, don't be a slave to fashion. I was too British, but it's hard to get it. But it was like, nice. Now, she was dressed up. You know, she's a respectable lady. So I'm not going to be, you know, one of these, I'm not going to say anything. But because I understood what she was getting at. I mean, you're not going to tell a lady, you know, hey, well, look at you. You know, you're look at your glasses. They're fashionable. That's being a, you know, a jerk. You know, that's being a juvenile. Okay, that's being a juvenile. Leave that for another time. I mean, because that's not the point that we were talking about. And being presentable is nothing wrong with being presentable. And, you know, which helps her feel confident. And, you know, she's saying, I'm a person of means and attainment and, you know, have strong roots in you know, intelligent, you know, friends and family and all that kind of stuff. And that's fine. Okay. Her dress is kind of like black and white, maybe, but maybe her mind was very black and white, which is good. Which is good. So there's two ladies there we were talking. And I was like, I felt so odd. And I said, wow, I'm getting older. I'm actually talking, you know, to people like this, and people are like treating me differently now. It's kind of like sir, and you know, they're willing to talk with me like maybe I know something. It's just like very different. It's very weird. Getting old is really weird, believe me, it is. I'm like shocked. I say, what's going on? Well, I'm getting older and people are viewing me differently, and I'm sort of, you know, kind of like people like kind of want to, you know, pat me on the shoulder, and they kind of feel, you know, a little more protective and nicer to me and all this kind of stuff. I'm like, what happened to, you know, to the, you know, what's going on here? I kind of don't, you know, like it a little bit, but also it means that people view you as older, which isn't so great. Very interesting. Wow. So we're not really answering the questions of the four turnings. We're turning it for the fifth time. We're involved in the action of turning the wheel for a fifth time. So this is very different. And accepting this, I feel very liberated by accepting this. So I'm not really involved in the first other four turnings. My goal is this fifth turning. And it's different. You know, it's a different emphasis, you might say. Each turning sort of is a different emphasis. And the turning is like just being knocked out. Like, wow, just really knocking me out. This turning of the wheel is just knocking me out. And it's either that or not. You know, there's no explanation because we haven't, it's not fully turned yet. We've turned yet. You got to wait until it's turned, until we really start to see, oh, so this is it. At least most people do. So whereas the other stuff that's established, and people can ask all sorts of questions because they think they know what it is. But right now, they don't know what it is. And you can't know what it is, but you can enjoy the turning of it. You can be part of it. A Course in Miracles is part of it, a turning of the wheel here. Absolutely. Big time. Turning the whole wheel on Christianity. The whole wheel is being turned here. And, you know, I've been part of it, you know, very, very, very integral part of all this turning of the fifth wheel. Turning a wheel for the fifth time. The fifth turning of the wheel. The fifth turning of the wheel. Of Dharma. Of spiritual understanding, spiritual protection. Okay, fifth turning of the wheel. These pictures have better focus, don't they? In terms of... because there's no play of light back and forth. So they don't go out of focus. That's nice. I'm not showing all of them. Some are just like, this is a very powerful one for sure. Some are just extraordinarily powerful. Imagine if you just had this. I put a holy card on the speedometer and odometer of the car, tachometer. I slipped it in there in the plastic between the glass and plastic. So I'm driving. I'm looking at what St. Jude's right there. I used to have holy cards of Sri Sri Narayana all over the place. My room, living room, in the car, around my neck. But it was just like, I was just completely, you know, flipping the script. And it was just, people would think I was too weird. It was freaking them out. So I had to, she just put a stop to it. I had them everywhere. My wallet. So wherever I go, there's a picture of her. Holy card picture of her. No, what's wrong with having these holy cards? People are, you know, what's wrong with it? I mean, we don't need to talk about those who are doing, you know, negative weirdness, what they're doing, all right? Let's just talk about what's wrong with being right. What's wrong with being right? Hinson did this song, like, I think it's what's wrong with being right. No, that was the Hinson's, wasn't it? Yeah. No, see, Mama Cook. The Cooks. Or what was that? I'm getting confused. Was it the Cooks, or what was it? The Singing Cooks, or something like that? Maybe what's wrong with being right? Yeah, with the Singing Cooks. What's wrong with listening to music like that? Like I said, I listened to the song Old Fashioned Singing, George Joe's Tammy Wynette. It's one of the best songs I've ever heard. I mean, it's an absolute jewel. Old-fashioned singing. It's on YouTube. You can listen to it. George Jones, Tammy Wynette. Man, oh man, oh man, did they not knock me out with that song. And others too who have the sensibility. It just knock you out. It is just. The sensibility of the song is so nice. So beautiful. Got the Nashville edition and the Jordanaires and Billy Sherrill producing it. Got the, you know, the A-Team in Nashville doing the vocals. And then George Jones and Tammy Wynette. And just, I mean, the whole thing is like just top drawer. Totally top drawer. And then the song itself is just awesome. Beautiful sensibilities. What's wrong with having beautiful sensibilities? What's wrong with having spiritual sensibilities? What's wrong with being with positive weirdness? What's wrong with positive weirdness? Right? We need to start asking ourselves this question. What's wrong with positive weirdness? Is it, you know, was right? What's wrong with hanging out with Longchenpa? That's positive weirdness. People say, oh, you're hanging out with Longchenpa? That's really weird. Yeah, positive weirdness. Longchenpa, I'm praying to Longchenpa. He's answering my prayers. Yeah, that's positive weirdness. Someone was telling me today that they had this illness, and instead of, the doctor said, you need surgery, and so instead of that, he asked everyone for prayers, and so all these church and community, a lot of people were praying really, really intense prayers for him, and he got better. He got well. He said, wow, I feel good. I don't even need the surgery. And he called up his doctor. The surgery was scheduled. He says, doc, I'm calling off the surgery. Doctor says, why? I said, I'm well. The doctor says, what? Well, how'd you get well? I says, prayer. And the doctor said, Bayer? Bayer? Like Bayer aspirin? He thought he said Bayer, not prayer. In other words, so to the doctor that was like, really weird. Prayer? But you got better through prayer? I don't know if Bayer would like prayer to be, what we do. It's like too weird for the pharmaceutical folks, isn't it? They say, oh, it's so weird, prayer. Yeah, but I find pharmaceuticals to be extremely weird. Totally weird. I find the modern world to be extremely weird. Way too weird. In a negative way. Very weird in a very negative way. Wow. All right, it's getting kind of late, but at least I was able to do this here for you and introduce this concept of positive weirdness. This idea of positive weirdness. This is kind of a weird surreal, right? But it's positively surreal, isn't it? How beautiful is this? So I've taken technology and tried to give a positive weirdness to it. And to me, this is the best art. I mean, this is what art, the highest type of art is this positive weirdness. Not just weirdness, a positive weirdness. I mean, really beautiful and meaningful and profound, like a lightning bolt. I mean, this is just, it's just wow. I mean, right? It's just wow. Longchamp is here with us with in the poppies, I guess. Or these are, I don't know what to say or whatever. It could be whatever. It's just very positive weirdness, positive wow. So this is, of course, what I've been trying to do. And you see the videos I'm making with some of the beautiful video background. I try to make it as beautiful as possible, and then introduce the profound Dharma King or Dharma Queen element in it, which is reminding us that these the this extreme positive weirdness is calling to us, saying, I'm here. Get used to me. Get used to me. I'm here to help you. I'm like an older brother or sister. I'm here to help you. And yeah, pray to me. Absolutely. Longchamp even told someone, I might have been Jigme Limpa, or possible one of those he appeared to. He said, "I will appear. I will answer your prayers if you want to see me, and you want transmission. You want clarification, and absolutely, I will. Focus on me. Really want it. Ask for it. Pray for it. I'll show up." And he has. In the great prayer made November 2, 2013, I just laid it all on the line. I said, "This is it. I'm just completely prayerful for some help." And I was 100% authentic with it. And the next night he showed up. He responded. Here's someone who responds to our prayers, plain and simple, as does St. Jude. Actually, St. Jude does as well. Many, many people have experienced this. St. Jude is a heavyweight. St. Jude was, of course, the co first cousin of Jesus. His father was the brother of St. Joseph. Jesus is, called, I don't know, he called step, I don't know if we call it stepfather. What do you call it? His non-paternal father, you might say. His non-paternal father. St. Jude, I'm sure Jesus and St. Jude, spent their childhood together. Probably they lived close by. And his mother was a cousin of, was somehow related to the Virgin Mary too. I mean, this was like very close family, St. Jude, very close. So St. Jude answers our prayers also. And this is not just fanciful talk. I'm saying this is true. Now, it's weird, isn't it, to have prayers answered? Sure it is. But it's positive weirdness. Positive weirdness is where it's at. Okay? Positive weirdness is where it's at. And too many people are trying to play it cool, the corporate way of saying, no, I don't like weirdness at all. Well, you know what? Society right now, corporate society, is extremely weird. It's unpalatably weird for me. Okay? Just contemporary society, modern day culture, is extremely negatively weird. And so what they're saying is like, well, I don't want any weirdness. Well, what do you mean? You're eating it, you know, morning, noon, and night. The extreme weirdness of our society, our culture, our world now, in a very negative way. So to say I don't like weirdness is ridiculous. It's absurd. We just choose between either negative or positive weirdness. It's the only choice we really have to make here. Yeah, I like this. I like this one. This is, I really like this. These formats, I have different formats, and it's just like, wow, this is beautiful. I was an acquaintance of a great painter who did very positive paintings. And people said, you know, it's too weird. You know, it's too, it's, what are you trying to do? It's too nice, too spiritual, too this or that. You know, that's just, but, you know, it's positive weirdness. That's fine. And we're taking it a little step further here. We're saying, well, somebody who passed away in 1364 is here now, or is relating with someone, praying to someone who passed away. They think, well, that's weird. You know? Well, the body passed away, but not the mind. The mind that taught still lives. It didn't go anywhere. Sky-like nature of mind. The body doesn't have anything. Doesn't have anything to do with the body, really. It just uses it as a communication device for those who still want to believe that the body has something to do with anything. But his mind is still very much with us, very alive, more alive than ever. I mean, perfectly alive, you might say. So, of course, like, our mind is too. So what do you mean? It's weird to visit with Longchenpa or ask for help or something. That's not weird. He's right here. So, the world's divided among those who believe in prayer and those who don't. And they're, you know, they've gotten prayer out of school, out of public places. They've tried to get rid of prayer. It's a modern culture, tech culture. You know, they believe in the efficacy of smartphones and whatever. That's their belief, and they think prayer is just like totally weird, weirds them out. Well, I think technology's weird, weirds me out. Touch screens weird me out. I don't use them. I don't understand how does it work. I was looking at someone's smartphone today, and it was like cracked like a spider web, so many cracks, and yet the touch screen still worked. I said, how's that possible? He said, I don't know. It's weird, isn't it? I said, yeah, it's very weird. Touchscreens are just weird. I don't like them. I don't use them. Very, 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 very weird. But some people love that weirdness. I don't. I don't really love the weirdness of technology. I don't. So I love the weirdness of prayer. Affirmation, assertion, flipping the script, full stop, the way. I love all that. I love that weirdness. And So there's just like two styles of weirdness, and they don't see eye to eye at all. And the thing is, we have to use technology, but technology people don't have to pray. So it's not an even playing field at all. The thing is, they make us use computers in school. Well, we should also then allow, our, we should pray in school, right? Why not? There's two different religions, two different systems of weirdness, and there's a lot of students who are really into prayer, and that find the modern curriculum of technology very weird. It weirds them out. So why should they be discriminated against? Our modern society is extremely discriminative. They're saying, well, our style of weirdness is good, we love it, and your style is terrible, we don't love it. Well, we do love our style of weirdness, positive weirdness. We love it. We absolutely love it. We adore it. And there's a few of you out there. Not many, it seems like. We've been intimidated, but every now and then, someone will just tell me, "Wow, I really just love that. It just knocked me out." Positive weirdness, and we need to really, see what we can do as far as rallying our minds to this. Again, in school, we are just hit with a barrage of what I find to be negative weirdness. Really, really. I look at curriculums, students, I just say, this is terrible. It's so bizarrely weird to me. And they say, well, that's state, you have to do it. Have to do this stuff, have to use, and soon there'll be more and more, you have to use technology. I find that's like saying you have to be weirded out. So it makes me very, very uncomfortable. So if they insist on that, why can't I insist it? Then okay, let me I have a right then to also enjoy positive weirdness, what I'm comfortable with. And if that weirds you out, well, that balances things out. That's only fair, isn't it? It's only fair. There's no fairness anymore in this culture, is there? No more fairness. So they're not willing to play fair at all. This is what I found out. They're not willing to. They want to abolish your weirdness, but they won't abolish their weirdness, right? They're willing to tell you got to put up with their weirdness, but when you tell them they got to put up with your weirdness, no. You see, that's where the no arises, the objection from them arises, and then they stop being so nice. So it's completely imbalanced, out of whack, unfair, unjust, discriminatory society we live in. They want to look at textbooks. Why don't I go to school? Say, well, you're forcing me, telling me I got to attend school. Why can't I spend my time looking at prayer cards and praying in school? Oh, you can't pray in school? What do you mean? Not praying is extremely weird. Okay. You're having me do all this bizarre ritual of some weirdness of modern curriculum. I find that just to be, magic, to be utterly bizarre and weird. And not believing in prayer to be extremely weird. And all this stuff, and you're saying, I have to do that. And yet when I do something what I feel is normal and not weird or positively weird, let's say, you say, no, you can't do that. You can't do it. And it's illegal. You can't do it. You gotta stop it. Is that a fair and just diverse society, or is that an intolerant society? It's an intolerant society. Extreme intolerance in our society right now. It's maybe the worst there's ever been. Because we're lying about it. We keep screaming how tolerant we are. We're extremely intolerant culture and society. It's a disgrace living in such a society. Really, it's disgraceful. And people don't even ask the right questions. We want to say, wait a minute. Well, what's fair? I don't see any fairness here. We spend half an hour on Lockean logic. Let's spend half an hour on praying, the logic of prayer. Oh no, you can't, it's religion. What do you, well, wait a minute. It's just weirdness, positive weirdness, and the stuff you're saying is negative weirdness. It's a belief system in terms of happiness, and tech is a belief system of happiness. It doesn't matter whether you invoke God, a God of happiness or not. It's still a belief system, a religious belief system. Oh no, they say, no. Can't have a religion in school. What do you mean? School is a religion. Secularism is religion. Humanism is religion. They say, no, it's not. Well, that's how they're trying to wiggle out of this and impose their will upon us. Yes, it is a religion. You don't need God to have a religion. The religion means to be very dedicated to something, to a belief system. That's what it means. Dedication to a belief system in many, many ways, different ways. And they're certainly dedicated, are they not? Of course they are. So they're very religious in their dedication. They just want to be able to define, you know, what is positive weirdness and what's negative. And we disagree with, completely disagree. So where's the they say they're diverse? No, they're not. No diversity. It's despotism. We're fair. We put up with secularism. They don't put up with, you know, prayerism. They want to get rid of it. They're radically active towards trying to get rid of it. And like I said, you never see anyone pray. When's the last time you saw someone praying in public? We always pray it every time we sit down to eat, whether it's in a restaurant or anywhere. But nobody else does that. Nobody else does it. I cannot tell you the last time I saw anybody in a restaurant praying before the meal. Or I think I'm the only one. That's crazy. Why should people impose their secularism on us in restaurants? What kind of society is this? If I can live with their non-prayer, they should be able to live with my prayer. I find non-prayer to be very, very bizarre and weird. And quite frankly, foolish. And yet I have to put up with that. I find it very difficult. I feel very uncomfortable with people not praying. So I have to put up with that. Why can't they put up with, then they should be able to put up with their discomfort for me praying, other people praying. There shouldn't be pressures to not pray. It's just very obvious, isn't it? You start looking at it, it's very obvious. How unjust our society is. How fundamentally unjust it is. And how it trumpets how just it is, when in fact it is extremely unjust, and refusing to acknowledge it. They want to institutionalize this refusal to acknowledge the injustice of it. They want to institutionalize it politically, socially, economically, in every which way, institutionally, in every which way they can. And they've got, you know, they've got their people in place to say, well, you know, it's prayer's not that important. As long as you do good works, you know, you give money to your charity. So they're trying to like wrap all religious activity, which should permeate your life, into just one activity of writing a check to somebody at a, you know, kids foundation, and you know, you're good. That's it. And they said, we can live with that. That's not where it's at. Only that, that's fine. You do that and you do 100 other things. You pray before our meals or after meals. The discussion during meals is spiritual, religious discussion. You look at artwork as holy artwork and holy cards. And your books are, you know, radical Dzogchen and non-dualist books, and your study is that. And, you know, you have prayer beads and you pray and you go to church or temple or wherever you ashram, you meditate, you contemplate, you do retreats. The music you listen to is you know, non-secular music. It has sacred themes to it. Your life is permeated by it. It's not about just writing a check to charity, Kids Foundation. That's a trick. That's a trap. And they've got the people now are saying, yeah, good works. That's it. Good works. And, you know, don't say much about it. Just, you want to write a check, you know, feel free to write a check and pat yourself on the back and say, that's what, you know, faith is all about. That's what God wants me to do. That's, you know, no. God wants you to be all in. Be really positively weird. Believe in prayer. Believe in these great teachers. Believe in the fifth turning of the wheel of Dharma. Sing the songs. Listen to this music. Wow. I might do a song list. I have a CD that I made long ago when I was really into country gospel and trying to get, you know, get this a movement going of positive weirdness through music. And it failed, completely failed. Everything I've done to get a movement going of positive weirdness has failed, entirely failed. Except this YouTube, it has some traction here, a little bit of traction. But again, people are like, how weird do you want me to get? don't worry, I feel great. I feel wonderful. I mean, this is very enjoyable. I mean, how beautiful is this? Look, is that beautiful? Yeah, it's beautiful. It's wonderfully beautiful. So what's wrong with wonderfully beautiful? Sacredly beautiful. Sacredly beautiful. Use the Dharma kings and queens. Don't use other people. It's a big mistake. Big mistake. Keep it at the highest elevation of the Dharma kings and queens. Like when you're using like these picture frames and making it really sublime, use them. That's what they're here for. We have Rama and Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Longchenpa. This is a figurine of him. We have stylizations of Jesus. You know, use that for the artwork. You better, that's playing it safe. It's playing it the right way. Because we're pointing to our liberation. Okay, this is what we're looking at. People say, well, that's weird. You believe in salvation? Of course we do. We believe in dropping our arrogance, which means we just then default to our natural state. When we stop trying to change what we are, then we'll be what we are, which is perfect, which is divine. That is what we are, without trying doing anything to establish it. Now, the 60s was positively weird in some ways. It was also negatively weird, but there's a lot of positive weirdness in the 60s. And, you know, I appreciated that. And again, I want to thank everybody that was part of the 60s and the 70s. I miss you. I miss those times. I miss the positive weirdness that, you know, we courageously did it. But keep in mind, I'm a child of all of that. And so I haven't quit. I never quit. I never sold out. To the negative weirdness. I haven't quit. I'm still pushing this positive weirdness here. It's just gotten more sublime as all, okay? But I love all our efforts that we made. Really, it was just so many, many, many of us doing such wonderful work in so many different ways. And so, you know, don't stop. You know, don't fail. To say, hey, I I've got it in me. Just like I started singing again. You find out maybe you still got it in you. To be positively weird. Start being positively weird. And maybe like riding a bike. Like, oh, I can still do it. Now, I can still sing. I don't know if I will or not, but it's about super confidence, having super adamant, confident, adamant, intense, soulful, those factors. Like, put all that together. Very soulful, creative, soulful, intense, adamant, and confident. Now, when you have those attributes, and you know, you practice, and you're musical, and everything, you could sing. It's fiery, you know, it's powerful, it's soulful. And it's beautiful. So, I'm meeting these people in my age group now. We're going now the 60s. And, you know, we were in the 60s, weren't we? And why can't we say, hey, you know what? Let's give it one last burst here. Remember the Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Yeah, I mean that was positively weird, wasn't it? It kind of got a little bit negatively weird too in some ways, but it yeah, there's positively weird stuff, but there's all different types of positive weirdness taking place. People are just meditating. They just go sit somewhere and probably just I'm just meditating. They have beads on and meditation beads, and they'd meditate. And what are you doing? I'm meditating. Like, wow. And we weren't afraid to be positively weird. What happened? What's happened to us, you see? And do we not have one last burst in us? Maybe we do. Because the whole corporate thing, the whole globalization, new order thing, that is really, really negatively weird. I mean, this, so, we're up against it here. And we, just like in the 60s, we were up against it. And are we really completely burned out? I don't know. Maybe not. Longchenpa doesn't look burned out, does he? Kind of looks burned in. And this time we're leaving drugs out of it, right? The sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, we're leaving that out of it. We're going to for the sublime. We're going from real positive weirdness, really profound positive weirdness. I mean, I'm trying to lead the charge. I said Jesus is back a year ago, and I did a Facebook page on it. I tried to website and everything. I told videos. He's back. How positive weird is that? How positively weird is that? But people are—they're playing it too safe right now, So, but maybe Well, I don't know. I don't know what could happen. But whatever it is, it better happen, right? Whatever it is, it better happen. So, welcome to positive weirdness here, and enjoy, and be knocked out by it. You say, what's my role? Be knocked out by it. Okay, let me tell you easily, just plainly, what's your role? For most. Well, all of us, actually, I'm knocked out by it too. All of us, be knocked out by it. Were we not knocked out by the 60s? Did it not knock us out? Absolutely, I was knocked out by it. And the 70s, just wow. Just knocked out by it. So our role is to be knocked out by it. Okay, that's wonderful. Just be knocked out by it. Okay, that's what we're missing. We weren't afraid to be knocked out by it. We weren't corporate. Corporate doesn't want you to be knocked out by it, does it? Wants you to be a good little sheeple, but no, we said to heck with that. We're gonna be knocked out by it. Unfortunately, a lot of us, we use drugs to try to be knocked out instead of just be naturally knocked out because we didn't have the full stop and the wow technique. We do have it now. So we don't need drugs. We can be naturally knocked out. I was knocked out by that song by Bradford. Knocked me out. It really just stunned me and knocked me out. I was positively stunned by it. And I listened to another one tonight. Again, I was positively stunned by it. I hope he does more videos. I'll put a link to him in the description, maybe. Take a listen. I mean, he's done a couple of videos, a number of videos, and maybe we could encourage him to do some more. I say, hey, brother, You're knocking us out. Keep knocking us out. Thank you very much. Thank God. I mean, you got a style that just knocks us out. And here's a troubadour of the revival, of the knockout revival. You know, the wow revival. He's a troubadour of the wow revival. We've got a troubadour here, really. I'll tell him that. He's very approachable, you know. He's a troubadour. And his style is just a knockout style. It really is. You know, the 60s, who we had? Donovan, remember Donovan? Oh my God, Donovan just knocked me out. It's just awesome. In the 70s or 80s, Cat Stevens was there, was doing some beautiful stuff. A lot of musicians, you know, but Donovan in the 60s, wow. He was weird in a positive way, wasn't he? Oh, wow. Hurdy-gurdy man, you know, it's just so many. Try and Catch the Wind, remember that song? Holy cow. I mean, the music knocked us out. Him, Jimi Hendrix, all on the Watchtower. And Donovan was a more spacey, spiritual kind of thing, but all on the Watchtower. Holy cow. It still knocks me out when I listen to it. It's just like, whoa. So we have a troubadour that's right now putting videos on. He's starting to do more in 2016. And let's go listen to it. Let's start knocking ourselves out. Seriously. Seriously, here. Let's start knocking ourselves out. Okay. Very great. All praise to the Dharma King Longchenpa and Jesus and Ramana and Dharma Queen Sri Srinandamayi Ma, who are just absolute knockouts. Absolute knockouts. Thank God for all of you. We absolutely thank God for all of you, and may we reflect just how awesomely, sublimely knockoutish you are. May we all reflect your knockoutishness and positively reflect that, you know, so others to see, because you deserve it. You deserve to be put in the right frame, in the right format, that you are absolute knockouts. And we praise you for this. Amen. Thank you, God. That's it.